Hello everybody and welcome to this playthrough for Pro and Expert Division with various wins. Before we have a closer look at all the content here in this video, make sure that you do hit the thumbs up button, also subscribe to the channel and turn on the notifications. Doing those three things doesn't cost you a dime and it helps the channel immensely. For those of you that do want to invest more in your game and become a better player quicker, then you can scan the QR code here on the screen or use the link that is in the description down below, patreon.com/golfclashtommy. And for those that are looking for more free content as well, our website golfclashtommy.com is the place where you can find loads and loads and loads of free content to learn from. All of the info box on the right hand side to get to the club distance adjustment, elevation adjustment, also a ball and club type I suggest you to play with. Have in mind that those are all suggestions and you don't have to follow it if you don't want to, but there's always a plan behind it. So let's go to hole number one. For hole number one, here we are going to start with our Apocalypse, and with Apocalypse level 5 plus, we're starting just before plus 0 yard mark. This allows us to play with the lower level Apocalypse as well, as we will not be close to max line. 3 right spin, and we're going to do all from, you know, 4 to 6 bars of top spin, depending on what type of wind direction we do have off tee. 2 balls of right curl with just before circle drop. The reason I'm using the circle drop overpower is to allow for everyone, regardless if you have grid lines or not, to be able to follow the curl suggestion in the best possible way. We do want to get the ball to around 365 yards. When we have got here, we do have a short iron towards the pin. And what is important with this particular short iron is to find a spot that allows us to land either on the fringe or on the green with our first bounce. Why is that? It's because we do want consistent bounces. If we are bouncing on the fairway before the green, we're most likely going to have very irregular, very crappy bounces, missing either left or right, or at least it's going to be very difficult to be dropping it as much as we want. Set the yellow ring by the edge of the fringe, ball guideline through the hole, then we are adding spins to get the ball guideline just short of the hole. 10% elevation is what we are looking for as elevation, and then it's like true club distance. So here we're playing approximately 50% of our club, and we are using the thorn. You can use whatever short iron you prefer to use, but we do recommend to use a short iron that do give you a good ball guideline, because that will help you a lot when attacking the pin here from distance. Perfect ball it is. We bounce on the fringe up towards the pin, dropping dead center for the eagle. For hole number two, here I'm going to play on the first fairway, bouncing down towards the pin. We are using 1.6 bars of topspin, and I'm setting this topspin with a basic ball. This to allow myself to not get any accidental side spin. Now, the tricky part is to have the ball guideline in the correct way, and the ball guideline is then coming down in between the dark and the bright green square row. Looking at it now afterwards, I would have loved to be a little bit more left, because that's what the picture was showing, the one picture was showing in an old guide that I tried to follow. Minimum distance plus 45% elevation is what I'm using, and here minus 45% elevation is not the true elevation. It's an increased elevation to allow to compensate for the wind push. Because once we do hit the ground, we're going to have a very high bounce, and that will also be affected more than normal by the wind. Tough par 3 to get. There are rough bumps, sand bumps and stuff like that that you can go with. But this type of bounce down is often what we have ended up with playing in the end. On the drive here on hole number 3, we are going to play straight down the fairway. Don't get fooled by the left fairway being so open. You will have no chance to reach to the green in 2 if going that way. So we're forced to go straight forward. We're bouncing over the rough and the sand as our normal type of play. If we'd be having a strong tailwind and more or less a direct tailwind, we can go over the rough and the sand directly and land above that part with our first bounce. You can probably drive green if you are able to use a special ball and you have the perfect wind, but it's not something I'm going to go into here in this particular video, because it's gonna be just one of a kind type of wind angle and wind strength. Max plus 10 on the drive, and then we're going to move on to the second shot. Here you have a decision to make. Either you go for a rough bump that is above the bunker, or you bounce before. Now, the drive I had wasn't really in the distance that I wanted, and therefore I somewhat forfeit the rough bump in this instance and go for a bounce over instead. Bounce over is always going to be super safe, and you will always have a chance for an albatross, but the best way to drop an albatross consistently here is to play into the rough bump. There is a funnel spot that is a little bit to the right of the pin, if we're looking at it from the tee to pin perspective, when bouncing into the rough. And the rough that I'm thinking about bouncing into is the rough that is above the bunker, not before. So an albatross is definitely a possibility, but you're gonna have to work quite hard on this par 5. On hole number 4, here we are going to play very similar to the intention of the golden shot that is at the moment active in the game. We are looking to have the top of the blue ring by the fringe, ball guideline through the hole with max backspin. Adjust is going to be max plus 30. And again, the 30 is not the true elevation here, but I'm using an increased elevation to allow for the elevation to compensate for the push after the first bounce. We make the adjustment, we center the ball, and we hit perfect, and then we will hit that downslope, and the ball will slow down, and we're dropping dead center for the hole in one. This is a par 3. By being able to play this type of way, is going to allow you for many hole in ones. If you do not have the backspin with the sniper, which you don't have if you have like a sniper 8, 7 or 6 or something like that, then you can always play the guardian instead, that you will always have a lot of backspin, or you can go and move back and play with your grizzly or B52 or something like that and play from the first pad. But this type of way is definitely going to be the best way to attack for an hole-in-one. Take your game to the next level with our Ultimate Tournament Tech Scout for the Aquatic Retreat 9-Hole Cup Master Division. If you do want to be competitive without having to spend hours in the practice mode, then our guides are the best ones to get. Scan the QR code here on the screen, or you go to patreon.com/golf-tommy via the link that is in the description down below. If you are a player that just not looking for the tournament guides, but you may also look for tour guides and checkpoint challenge, we have something for you as well. So make sure to select the package that suits you the best. And if you do have any questions before sign up, you can always email our beautiful support at support@golf-tommy.com. On hole number 5, I want to show you a more aggressive way of playing this hole. Because in every single playthrough I've ever done, I've always just pinged the ball down left, showed you the way to either go for a rough bump or go for a bounce over. Obviously, that can still be applied. But here, for those of you that do have the possibility to use some more topspin, you can go on the right-hand side on this fairway to actually bounce over the water. What that will do is that you will somewhat take a shortcut towards getting a short iron instead of getting a long iron or a wood club. But it do require a lot of topspin. So either if you do have a high level apocalypse, or you do have like a high level big topper, you can also have Thor's hammer to get yourself down there. But again, to be perfectly clear, you don't have to play this way. And if you do not have the club or the ball for it, then you can absolutely get yourself down the left hand side and just play the standard way, which is more conservative, obviously, and it will be less drops with that, but it will still be a chance. Now, on the second shot, I'm using my Thorn. I'm doing a pin check here, and you can see that we are approximately around mid-club. Doing a no-spin play here is, for me, the preferred way, because that will allow me to then be consistent with my landing spot. Because if I would be starting using backspin or using side spin, it could be that I'm adding just a little bit of spin here and there that might make me be a little bit further back or a little bit further up and stuff like that. 10% elevation, and you can see that I center the ball and it's perfect. The ball that I'm playing with is called a Luminary, which is possible to win for free in Master Division and also in Expert Tier 3. I'm not sure about Tier 2, to be honest. Maybe someone in the comments could let us know about that. But there is many other ball types that has similar stats to that. But again, a bit more aggressive play. And like I said in the beginning, I wanted to show a bit more aggressive play this time, as I've always been showing the more conservative play on this hole. For hole number 6, if you do have a headwind, this is going to be a very tough one to get yourself an attack on the Albatross. And that's why I'm showing you a more aggressive put play where we're playing with a power 5 ball of tee, also using a lot of topspin on the big boy clubs. Again, if you do not have a good club and a ball with this type of wind, then you're going to have to play for an eagle, most likely. Because this is a long par 5 and there is not really much we can do. And then you're gonna have to play the similar type of way. We get the ball over like this, and from here we're going to just safely get ourselves down towards the green. It might be that you have to use overpower if the wind is too nasty when it comes to the headwind. But again, I wanted to show a more aggressive put play here in a wind that people very often just give up and just grab the eagle. But there is possibilities to this as well. Cataclysm on the approach here. We don't have to have a high level of cataclysm. We can also play the big dog. But if you do have a cataclysm, then you will see yourself having at least a good ball guideline compared to the big dog. No elevation on the approach, and we're going to be close to max line once we have adjusted, and that's also the number that we are going to use. Now, the reason we're aiming at the edge of the rough line is because the headwind will then make the ball fly shorter, meaning that we're going to land further back than where we aim. So we are adjusting, we are going to center the ball, and we're going to hit perfect. This is, once again, a more aggressive put play on this hole. And again, like I said, on hole number 5, I have been putting out very and many conservative ways here. And I can say safely that in tailwind and in crosswind, you don't have to go with a big boy club and a big boy ball. But in headwind, this has always been a very difficult par 5. And I want to show you a way out of that that also allowed yourself to attack for the Albatross. On hole number 7, we want to play down the right-hand side if we do have a crosswind or if we do have a headwind. And also, if we do not have more than 6 bars of topspin to use. And the reason the topspin is important for the left-hand side is because then we're going to bounce over the big bunker and also the rough patch as well. So this is the more conservative way of playing. Again, you can push on the left-hand side, which somewhat is what I would like to prefer as being a little bit more aggressive as a player. And that's because it leaves me a short iron from the left, where here from the right side, it's not really leaving me a short iron. It's leaving me either a long iron or a wood club. Max plus 20 on the drive, and we are hitting perfect. We want this ball to get as far down the fairway possible without risking rolling into the rough there at the top. Again, we're playing this as a conservative way of playing where we want to give ourselves room both left and right and also, you know, forward or whatever it's called in English. Second shot, we play with our sniper. Here, I changed my mindset from going from a more conservative thinking to going a bit more aggressive. There is a pretty big patch of rough here, and I think this is a big patch of rough based off what we used to do when it comes to rough bumps. It's usually a bit more aggressive than this. But I feel like when we're playing such a long distance wood club, a rough bump from distance is the way to go because it disables the wind effect after the first bounce to a bare minimum. And that makes it so much easier than to dial it in from distance. Sure, you can back up and bounce on the fairway before the rough and the bunker. If you want to take it a little bit more conservative, this shot also. But the problem with that shot is that it's going to most likely need a pretty hefty offset because it's going to be looked in a way that the ball will have a much bigger effect after the first bounce and after the second bounce than what it will have if we go for the rough bump. Hole number 8 has always and will always be one of the tougher par 3s that we do have in the game. And the reason for that is mainly the two things. Number one, we are playing a massive downhill here, which means that the ball will be affected a lot by the wind. Second, once the ball hits the ground, that first bounce is going to be massive and also then be affected a lot by the wind. So to be able to compensate for that, you're going to have to use a lot of elevation, or you have to use a big offset, and both of those type of things are going to be very hard to consistently do in a good way. And therefore, you might get an occasional drop here and there with this type of hole or this type of play, but it's not going to be something that you will do on a consistent basis, because if you're having slightly different pull angle or stuff like that will also have an effect. Play on the beginning of the fairway before the bunker gives me a nice bounce towards the pin. In the worst case scenario, we are getting ourselves a birdie. Hole number 9, let's pray for a crosswind or a tailwind when we play it in the tournament for real. The reason for that is that in headwind, it's going to be a tough one, especially if you play with lower level clubs, especially if we do play with a higher wind and such, because it will force us to either use a better club or we are going to have to go with some overpower. Now, we don't have much wind to play with, which obviously is going to make this work. We set up at the +0 yard mark. We are using a max +10 adjustment, then it's outside wall left curl. The intention here is to trickle the ball down the second fairway, and you can see here now that with a great left, we would be dangerously close to that bunker. But we need to get it at least far enough here on the drive to be able to do the second shot as we are planning with the sniper. Because if we do go too short, we are going to force us to play with a wood club that may not have the ball guideline enough to attack the pin. And if you don't have that, that's going to be pretty disappointing, because the ball guideline is, in my opinion, essential here. Now we can use the beautiful ball guideline of the sniper to be able to attack the pin. It's all about finding a spot that is not glitchy or inconsistent, and that could be easier said than done. Now I'm leaving the ball guideline just short of the hole, thinking that the headwind will help to compress the ball guideline or the ball's roll when it comes towards the pin, but it's not. And that's actually a thing with this hole in particular, that even though we do have a headwind here, we need to leave the ball guideline slightly short of the hole or we will come in hot. No elevation on the second shot when we're playing through club, which is going to be close to max distance. Now you can see we may not come in super short, sorry, super hot, but hot enough to have the ball to roll over the hole. This has always been a tough par 5 to end up with the Cojones, and a par 5 where it's easy to make a mistake on the drive and then it's not easy to save on the approach. Thank you so much everybody for watching this playthrough for Pro and Expert Division here with various wins. Make sure to subscribe to the channel. Also, make sure to hit the thumbs up button before you leave. Scan the QR code here on the screen or use the link patreon.com/goldclashtommy that is in the description down below. That will take you to our premium guides where you can subscribe and start improving your game today. Thank you once again for watching. I wish you the best of luck in your Golf Clash game.